Good evening, everyone. Let me first really welcoming all of you fellow South Africans, family members who are here this evening. I saw some of my sisters and brothers, family. Thanks so much for making the time. Friends and colleagues from the business community, members of the press, if they are here. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening once more. It is actually a pleasure and honor for me to welcome you to the launch of my second book, Capitalist Crusader. I truly hope that this book gets South Africans talking, because it contains content that readers and commentators will unfortunately find difficult to ignore. Please allow me to take this opportunity to first thank the following people for their role in my life during the last few months. Moki Makura, who unfortunately cannot really be with us this evening, from MMME Publishers, for guiding me into the path of self-expression. Moki was instrumental in encouraging me to write my first book, my autobiography, Black Like You. And since then, I found that expression is a positive way of organizing my thoughts and sharing my vision for South Africa, the beautiful country that I so dearly love. Louis Grelton and Russell Flagg, Nicola, my publishers at Booksop. Louis has been a thoughtful guide through all the planning of this book, and Russell has been a real fatigious coordinator. Thank you very much for your role. Thank you to my ghostwriter, who has so eloquently turned my thoughts into words. Throughout the process of writing this book, my wife Connie, my children Kensani and Rulani, have endured my mental absence with their usual good grace, and I thank them for that. Finally, I'd like to acknowledge the unwavering support from my colleagues at the Free Market Foundation, in particular Leon Law, Eustace Davy, and Temba Noluchongo. I don't believe I can ever find appropriate words to do justice to describe who these gentlemen are. You are, to me, what I regard as true patriots. Our country is truly blessed to have you as its sons. Thomas Sowell, an American economist, social theorist, political philosopher and author, once said, and I quote him, "If you are not prepared to use force to defend civilization, then be prepared to accept barbarism," unquote. I choose words as my weapon of choice to reject such barbarism and to defend the rights of all South Africans to live an economically prosperous life. There is no reason, and no reason whatsoever, other than failing government policies as to why South Africa finds itself slipping in almost every sector. The purpose of this book, Capitalist Crusader, is to show readers how government policies deflate, frustrate, and abnegate South Africa again and again. For the past 21 years, we have been told how apartheid is the reason why South Africa finds itself in the current state. In Capitalist Crusader, I challenge this tired government rhetoric, instead examine where current government policy is leading us and what we can do to redirect the trajectory of our country. To be fair, we inherited a failing country in 1994, but it is evident that the vitality that's going to turn South Africa around isn't our capping government. It is South Africans, you and I, that can really make a difference in the future of the country. As a self-confessed capitalist, I embrace free market principles, principles that fed into democracy so seamlessly that I believe that capitalism is the only way that South Africa can pull themselves out of the poverty that our government today ignores. The government ignores major issues because they've always got their attention deflected by socialist and communist trade union cohorts who don't want anything to change because there's big business for them in poverty. If the trade unionists who espouse working for better employment conditions were sincere, they would support the Free Market Foundation in its challenge of Section 32 of the Labour Relations Act that makes it impossible for business, small businesses, to operate according to big business rules. With COSATU as its business partner, the government will never be able to sincerely address the diabolical poverty that exists in South Africa today. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the kernel of the issue. Therefore, it becomes incumbent on ordinary South Africans to take charge of the country's destiny. When we become mindful of the roles that we can play in effecting change, we might see the change that we envisage and so wish to have. We need to examine our attitudes to South Africa in order for us to effect this change. South Africa's constitution is a blueprint for expected behavior of all South Africans. It insists on the autonomy of our judicial system, and yet, unfortunately, COSATU, as a senior member of government, cautions the judiciary to tread carefully as it seeks to uphold the laws of the country. We simply have to reject continued interference in the country's strongest democratic institution. We can do this by demanding that our democratic institutions remain autonomous and are supported by citizens as they perform their duties. Part of being proactive in our future demands that we as citizens register our dissatisfaction at every opportunity. We cannot simply vote and hope that the party we vote for will have the best interests of the country at heart. At every opportunity, we have to make our voices work. We need them to be heard, challenge our leaders that stray towards the path of apathy, and join like-minded South Africans to ensure that our country develops democratically. The only people that can steer South Africa on its deserved path are South Africans themselves, you and I. We have to do away with divisive strategies that prevent us from joining together and making our government accountable. It isn't acceptable that our government employs cronyism to ensure that the agenda is enforced. It is also not acceptable that party politics is being decided by tribal agendas. It's also not acceptable that discriminatory laws determine who can work and who cannot work. It's also not acceptable that women are still devalued in patriarchal societies. It is also not acceptable that our social welfare system keeps people poor. And most definitely, it is not acceptable that business is regulated on every level so as to completely overwhelm entrepreneurship in our country that we so desperately need. If we are serious about living in South Africa that we so promised in 1994, then we have to take back the reins of power, and the power that can be stated by saying, enough. We have had enough of being bullied by a government who seeks to gag our press. We have had enough of being told on what terms and conditions we can work. Restriction on economic movements make of apartheid-style constraints. It is enough of being excluded from economic participation in national resources, where only the political elite get to mine the wealth of our nation. Enough of our inferior education that keeps our youth unemployed and unemployable. Enough of the inferior health system. Enough of incompetent civil servants. Enough of failing institutions. Enough of an immature leadership that isn't fit to steer the country in a responsible fashion that this country so deserves. My outrage and despair at the aimless state of the country and its leadership has resulted in me being labeled unpatriotic, no longer black, one of the so-called labor black, and all the other insulting labels they could think of. I can tell you, ladies and gentlemen, I'm an ordinary South African, and when ordinary South Africans are attacked for their dissenting views on government, we find ourselves in an autocratic society. We have to reject such oppression, reject dirty tactics, reject autocracy. I am most certainly a patriot. If I wasn't, I wouldn't put myself in the side of the government's firing line. Like many of you here tonight, I have young children, and it is for them and for their future at the future of your children, let us say it is enough. I urge all of you South Africans to reject the slippery slide that the government is erecting in the political playground. Instead, we have to pitch our level of expectations to the rights enshrined in our constitution and continually call on the government to adhere to this right. Some people might criticize me for being an idealist. If wanting to maintain a dignified life for all South Africans is idealistic, then I must accept such a labor. But I believe, and I'm more than idealistic, because attached to my hopes for a beautiful country are actions. And ideas supported by actions will result in a trajectory of change. If all of you join me in acting on your hopes and dreams for the future of our country, then collectively we will effect the changes that we need that can really help take our country forward. Ladies and gentlemen, as first chairman of the Free Market Foundation, I identified a single piece of legislation, and there are many, that I felt intolerably crippled employment in our country. I discussed this problem with business leaders, both locally and internationally. I wrote articles on it, discussed it on radio talk shows, and then I realized the next step was to make my dissent absolutely blatant. Through the Free Market Foundation, we challenged Section 32 of the Labour Relations Act in court. It has been met with vociferous objection, but I believe that we'll have our day in court and the judiciary will one day, eventually, make a decision that will enable the Minister of Labour in this country to fairly adjudicate the merits of each bargaining council's recommendations being put forward to him. Not everybody can take the decisions to court, that disrespect inspection to court, and accept that, because that is obviously an unreasonable expectation. But everybody has a voice. Every single person, I urge you to use your voice wherever you can find injustice, whether it's challenging an abusive partner or rejecting unfair discrimination. Let all of us say it is enough. Let the collective sound of that resounding enough deafen our leadership until they are forced to stop and take notice that it is enough, and it is enough, and it is enough. I hope that you all enjoy reading the book and you'll join me in demanding a sustainable economic path for our country and really take the responsibility for the future of this country. Thank you very much for really making the time. And I truly hope that all of you can really take decisions tonight to be true patriots, regardless of whatever label that you can really be given. That you've got a responsibility to protect this country, and the only way you can really do this is to really voice your dissatisfaction wherever you come across it. So thank you very much, and I hope to really see you again at the launch of my third book, which will be soon. Thank you very much.